Funding provided by...
You work hard to feed them well. That's why at Fairway, we're committed to our foundation of personalized service while treating our customers like family and valuing our employees. Fairway Meat and Grocery. That's what we're all about.
By Muskell Lighting, the sports lighting specialists, providing lighting systems for you, your project, and your community.
Small businesses are the backbone of Iowa's communities, and they are backed by Iowa banks. With advice, loans, and financial services, banks across Iowa are committed to showing small businesses the way to a stronger tomorrow. Learn more at iowabankers.com.
Fargo Arena, situated along the Des Moines River, and our host for the conclusion of this exciting weekend of Iowa Girls High School Hoops. Thank you, everybody, for joining us on our second and final night of tournament coverage broadcast to all 99 counties on statewide Iowa PBS. It's Pink Suit Saturday. It's Championship Saturday. We've already crowned four champions. And our 1A matchup will round out another year of girls basketball. Throughout the night, Iowa PBS Sports will continue to bring you the highlights, analysis, and features from here on the Sports Desk. And stay tuned for all the pageantry of these state basketball championships. First, though, let's go courtside. BJ Chabon and Laura Leonard, the last game of the season, the 1A state championship.
Thanks, Paul. So sad, but it is time for state championship basketball. It's the 1A title game as Marcus Meriden Cleghorn Remsen Union takes on the number two seed, the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears. Hi again, everyone, with Laura Leonard. This is BJ Chabon, and Laura, the starting five for each are pretty spectacular.
Well, and that's going to be a factor in this ball game because you have to dictate pace and tempo. Depth is going to be a problem for both these teams. Have to stay out of foul trouble.
Let's take a look at the Royals and their resume here. You know what? They've got loads of talent. They've got seniors that can really score it. And their semifinal win against Garrigan, well, that was Coach Jillian Lecce's 100th career win. Now on the other side, for Bishop Garrigan, they've been in the state title game before, 0-2. What can they do to get things going tonight? Audie Crooks has to play big, as does junior Molly Joyce. Can they get it done? It's time now for the presentation of the Iowa Bankers Award.
Fans, each year at the Girls State Basketball Tournament, the Iowa Bankers Association presents the Student Athlete Achievement Award to a student athlete who excels on the court, in the classroom, and in her community. The 2022 Student Athlete Achievement Award winner is Meredith Tigges from Bishop Garrigan High School. Presenting the 2022 award is Ben Kern from Iowa State Bank in Algona. Congratulations to Meredith, and thank you to Ben Kern with Iowa State Bank and the Iowa Bankers Association for their sponsorship of this award and continued support of the IGHSAU. And now, let's meet the teams playing in our 1A championship.
MMCRU fans, let's hear it for your Royals.
Garrigan fans, let's hear it for your Golden Bears.
Fans, it's now time to introduce the players in today's 1A championship matchup. First of all, for the Royals of MMCRU, number 5, Avery Schlanger. Number 13, Kennedy Tentinger. Number 15, Kirsten Lecce. 23, Kylie Harpinoff. 25, Sydney Creer. 31, Audrey Etter. 33, Mikan Yude. 41, Olivia Spenner. 43, Andrea Penning. And 51, Mackenzie Meyer. Your assistant coaches, Derek Mara, Danae Dreckman, and Dean Hilbrands. And now, let's meet your non-starters for the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears. Number 12, Elena Casey. Number 20, Reagan Murphy. Number 22, Zoe Montag. Number 30, Ashlyn Hovey. 32, Ella Muller. And 34, Kaylin Capacious. Your assistant coaches, Mick Elbert, Joe Bartolo, and Colin Schwab. And now, here are your starters for today's 1A championship. For MMCRU at guard, a 5'7 senior, number 3, Taylor Harpinoff. For Bishop Garrigan at guard, a 5'7 senior, number 2, Emma Granginette. For the Royals at guard, a 6-foot senior, number 11, Emily Dreckman. For the Golden Bears at guard, a 5'7 junior, number 11, Molly Joyce. For MMCRU at guard, a 5'5 junior, number 21, Cora Alish. For Bishop Garrigan at guard, a 5'7 sophomore, number 21, Abby Capacious. For the Royals at center, a 5'8 senior, number 35, Maya Holmes. For the Golden Bears at forward, a 5'9 senior, number 23, Meredith Tigges. For MMCRU, at center, a 6-foot senior, number 45, Ellie Hilbrands. And for Bishop Garrigan, at center, a 6'3 junior, number 55, Audie Crooks. Head coach for the Royals, Jillian Lecce. And for the Golden Bears, Brandon Schwab. Ladies and gentlemen, now turn your attention to the area in front of the scores table as I introduce your officials for this 1A championship as assigned by the Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union. Royce Reniger, Jason Slaughter, Kevin Schultz, and your bench official, Jared Ray. All right, who's ready for state championship basketball?
Let's get after it. Laura Leonard, what are the keys to the game here?
Well, for the Royals, what they need to do is read the defense. They need to read and react. Don't let the defense dictate what they do on offense. And they need to play lockdown defense. They need to try to control Molly Joyce and Audie Crooks. Easier said than done, but I'm sure they're going to have a good game plan. And then for Bishop Garrigan, they need to stay in the moment. It's a different opponent than what they thought they would have, but they need to play through that and then get the ball to the post. Get the post touches, have it run through Audie Crooks.
It's the final title game. Crooks will jump it for Garrigan. Hillebrands for MMCRU, and it's owned by Bishop Garrigan. Molly Joyce, the junior, will bring it ahead. Seventh trip to state, trying to garner that elusive state championship are the Golden Bears. This one can be tipped out. Joyce will pick it up. she's going to be locked in on by Aulish. What a great matchup right there. Aulish, a great lockdown defender. Joyce gets by her, can't get the bucket. Crooks with the rebound, put back is there, and an and one.
Well, there's the height advantage, and you're right. It's interesting to see how they were going to play it. Packing it in the middle, Joyce goes one-on-one. Audie Crooks reaches up above, pulls the rebound, gets the kiss off the glass.
Holmes picks up the foul for the Royals. Audie Crooks, over 40 Division I offers, will make her decision this summer, misses the free throw, and the rebound comes down to the Royals. Out ahead, and it's going to be turned over. Harpenau threw it ahead, was expecting Dreckman to cut in. Nothing there. Bishop Garrigan back with the ball again.
I think those are a little bit of the nerves that are showing initially in this ball game. The Royals are a team that have not been here, but Bishop Garrigan has been here multiple times.
Spot up jumper, in and out, capacious, the rebound, and it's blocked away by Dreckman.
Boy, got really good opening to get that rebound, but good recovery defensively by Dreckman.
Emily holds the ball now, sets up the offense. Scored 30 points so far here at the state tournament. Will attack the rim.
They're going to put the ball on the floor. They're going to put it in her hands, let her go one-on-one. Maybe try to get foul trouble inside on Crooks, but Crooks stayed away.
Little dump down, Joyce's shot. Crooks, her hands are so smooth. She's got four, all four.
I've said it every year that they have been at the tournament. She has the best hands of any center I have ever seen.
Gets the rebound here. Garrigan will outlet it ahead, and there's a turnover. Crooks tried to hit the touchdown pass. And it was behind Capacious. Watch this.
Yeah, just the touch of the hands and the reach, able to tip it to herself. She's just, we call them soft hands, and they are, because she can just pull everything in, and she's able to tip it to herself, gain control, and she does such a great job of keeping the ball up above her head.
Aulish at the top. Holmes will give way. Aulish will look to drive. Now the dump down. Harpenau, the kick out. Here's Hillebrands.
Hillebrands can do that. She's got that range. She can play inside, and that's where she plays a lot, but she can stretch the defense.
Royals have their first lead of the game. Joyce for three. Left it long, Hillebrands with a rebound, and she'll be fouled by Tigges. This is going to be interesting, Laura. All day long, ever since this matchup was announced, was each team had to stay out of foul trouble.
Good job of inside-out basketball. They get it in, defense somewhat collapses down, and able to kick out for the open three.
Dreckman lost it in traffic. Joyce up with it. She'll drive. What a hard spin to her right. What a beautiful layup. That's Molly Joyce.
You know she's been working on that one, because that was smooth as she gets the breakaway. And you know, she really prides herself on her defense. A lot of people see her as a scorer, and she is, but she has really developed into a nice defensive player.
Garrigan will try to add to their lead. Aulish with the board. School, Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn, Remsen Union, formed 7 years ago when they joined together. As this one's tipped out, it's going to stay with the Royals.
And that's when Coach Jillian Lecce took over this team, right after the merger of the teams and the schools.
Seen this senior class grow up together. Hillebrands will lose it. And another turnover here for Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn. Remsen Union, are they starting to show some jitters here early on?
I think so, a little bit. And it usually, if you haven't been in this game, in this environment before, you're going to maybe have those nerves. And you've got to play through them. or you've got to get a quick timeout, settle the team down.
Tigges buries it.
They've got so many weapons on this Garrigan team, and we've seen multiple scores so far in this first quarter.
Aulis will try to get it going. And Dreckman will be ran into. Let's see who this is against.
I think it's going to be on Molly Joyce.
Yep, her first. Team second. And Joyce, last couple of state championships, has gotten herself into foul trouble. Very aggressive player. This one's going to be tracked in backcourt. Free play here for Harpenau.
You know, we've kind of watched these players grow up here at the state tournament, and when they hit the tournament as freshmen, both Audie Crooks and Molly Joyce, you knew they were something special. You knew that they were going to progress each and every year, and their games were going to grow. And both of these players are getting, well, we know Audie Crooks is getting a ton of offers, and Molly Joyce is starting to get those offers as well.
Capacious has her shot knocked away by Hillbrands. Out ahead, here's Dreckman. And she'll be fouled by Crooks.
Good job of looking up the floor, seeing Dreckman in the open court. And Crooks reaches across, gets some arm. Got a lot of ball, but also got some arm.
To be the best, you gotta beat the best. Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union has put themselves in this position, as you see Bishop Garrigan go to their bench. Zoe Montag will check into the game for the first time. Beating Newell Fonda in the semifinals by 4. What a game. Shot 60% in the first half. And now it looks like the Royals also going to their bench. Kirsten Lecce will check into the game.
Taking a look over at the MMCRU bench, it looks like they're having a little pit stop, a tire change over there. Looks like they're switching out some shoes. And I can't tell who that is. It may be Aulis over there getting some new shoes on.
Audie Crooks takes advantage. She's got 6. Bishop Garrigan by 2. Harpenau, the kick out. Now the 3 by Hillbrands. Can't get it to fall. Dreckman had it taken away by Capacious.
Now, so if we've seen in every ball game, when you get the ball in your hands, you have to control it and you have to protect it. If you put it out there or bring it down to your side, somebody's going to sneak in and rip it from you.
Maya Holmes just picked up the foul, and that's going to be her 2nd. Again, neither team is very deep, so let's see how Jillian Lecce will play at the head coach for the Royals. And yep, new shoes for Cora Aulis. Gonna test them out here.
And they look brand new. She's walking over this way so we can take a look at them. They do look brand new.
I know each of these two teams enjoyed going to the shopping here in the capital city of Iowa. Aulis' shot off the mark and the rebound to Capacious. She's caught up in traffic, and Joyce will look to clear it here. Might have picked up those shoes over the last few days here.
What a time to break them in.
And a travel is going to be called on Montag. The freshman has played some really good minutes here at the state tournament for Bishop Garrigan.
Yeah, she struggled a little bit coming into the tournament, the 5 games prior. There's a good look at those shoes for Aulis. Hoping that they work and feel a little bit better as she goes up and down the floor. But Montag, 5 games prior to coming into the state tournament, 3 of 15 from 3-point range, and that's her role. But here at the state tournament, she's 4 of 6, and so has come up big when they've needed her.
This is the first ever meeting between the two teams. Joyce with a killer crossover. Whoa! Just could not get it to go down.
How about her navigating through the defense? Quick hands and quick dribble.
And they attack inside with Harpenau. She's 5'7", but not afraid to post up.
No, she's a player that She can shoot it from long distance, but she's a powerful player that she can post up, and if she can find a mismatch, she will be able to take advantage.
Interesting defensively how the Royals are playing it, and now a three ball put down by Tigas, her second of the game, and Garrigan has their largest lead at four.
They're taking their chances, leaving Tigas open. They are packing things in the middle, a packed line defense, if you will, and they're going to take their chances with the perimeter players.
Dreckman to the corner. Hillbrands can't get it to fall. And Garrigan, let's see what they do here. 4-point lead. You see the clock winding down here in the opening quarter. They're going to take a three with Montag. Can't get it to fall. And the Royals look to hurry. Lecce will go to the line.
Both of these teams will get out and run when they can, but they're doing a good job of understanding when to run and when to pull it back and set up in the half court.
Montag will pick up the foul, her first, fourth team foul on Garrigan, and the Bears go to the bench again. Emma Grandjeanette will check back into the game. She was part of the original starting five, and Ashlyn Hovey into the contest for the first time. Lecce makes one, misses the second.
And as soon as Molly Joyce grabbed that rebound, she just took a deep breath. We're going to hold, took a peek at the clock, and they're going to run for one.
Here's Joyce. Into the paint, left hand to Crooks. It's deflected, the shot up, no good, and that'll be the end of the quarter. 15-12, Garrigan with the lead.
Tigas with the big three. They've left her alone, and she's responded.
Let's go to Paul Yeager, who's standing by.
You never know on Championship Saturday what's going to happen. Well, first you have to get here, and let's show you how these two teams did in their semifinal games here at Wells Fargo Arena this week. This is Class 1A, and this is MMCRU against Newell Fonda. It's weird not saying Newell Fonda in the finals. The Royals, it was Ellie Hillebrands, Emily Dreckman, and then Hillebrands again, who hit a bucket here in this first quarter. And it was on to the celebrating. And man, I got caught up in that celebration of the fans in the hallways. That was wild, just like it was on the floor. Garrigan, they had a tough matchup with North Lynn. The Lynx gave them everything they could handle. Hovey to Molly Joyce. And then the drive again, this time it's Abby Capetius. And then Joyce too, you guessed it, Audie Crooks. Inside early, often. Crooks again as Garrigan rolled into the finals, 74-57. That's how we got here. Let's go now down there on the floor, BJ and Laura.
Thank you, Paul. 8 minutes to go here in the first half. Garrigan with a 15-12 lead. What's jumped out at you?
You know, I think the thing that is with the Royals, they have survived this first quarter. They've gotten the nerves out. They got them out early. They had a few mistakes, but they were able to kind of get their legs underneath them and battle toe-to-toe with Garrigan. Garrigan has not been able to get the ball in as much as they would like to into Audie Crook's hands. They've been able to get a few times into her. She's been able to get a couple of offensive boards, but they sure would like to have her have a few more touches here in this quarter.
Garrigan has scored 98 points in the paint here at the state tournament so far, including tonight's game. Been very dominant there. Now for Marcus Merritt and Claghorn, they're prone for turnovers, but that's okay. They have a hot shooting. So far, not off to the greatest of starts, but it's going to pick up now with Taylor Harpenau.
Harpenau, one of three players on that floor for MMCRU that has scored over 1,000 points in their career.
Now shooting at 50% for the game are the Royals. It's a one-point contest. Garrigan with the ball right now. Grandjeanette finds Capacious for her first bucket of the game.
Forgot about Capacious. She was down there for a good two or three count before they found her.
Three-point contest again.
Bishop Garrigan now in a zone. Royals gonna take their time. just kind of need to reload here and take a peek at it.
And this is going to be over and back.
I thought that was off of somebody else's, but maybe she touched it in the front court before it got to the back court.
Biggest question I think a lot of people have is this three is put up and drained by Capacious. The threes are raining in. Three-point field goals made so far by Garrigan. They open up a six-point lead.
And there's no defensive rotation right there, and that leaves Capacious wide open.
Let's go to the Garrigan huddle and hear from their head coach, Brandon Schwab.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, I like the zone. I mean, what, should we stay in purple for a while and just see?
Yeah.
Okay. Offensively, what about offensively? I mean,
all them girls.
Yeah. Hey, listen. Great run, you guys. Great run out of that timeout, okay? Win the next 2 minutes. Listen, three on Audie, just like we got with Abby on that cut. Find that gap that it's in. Cut to the open area. Keep your head up. Make the pass, okay? It's there. You guys score some points on that. Stay in purple on defense, okay? Listen, you made them reverse the ball for an entire minute that possession. They can't get it. Get it again, okay? Let's go. Hey, win this 2 minutes. Let's go. We are.
Purple on D.
They're going to stay in that zone, it sounds like. And you could hear them say they're going to have three players defending Audie Crooks, so make sure everybody else is moving, finding the opening, finding the gaps, and they're going to have to then come out of that defensively and find a different way to counteract this powerful Bishop Garrigan offense.
Royals will drive it and nearly turn it over. It's tied up, and they will turn it over. Possession arrow to Garrigan. That's Grant Jeanette, the senior, who's really put together a nice defensive tournament. Back coach Schwab said she's playing her best defense of her career right now.
And she's just a player that anticipates, gets long, gets hands out in the passing lanes, creates havoc.
Tiggis a little too hard on the pass, trying to hit her teammate Crooks.
Well, that's one of those where, and I've said all tournament long, and I've said for 3 years, all you have to do is throw it up near Audie Crooks, and she'll go get it. That one was just a little bit out of her reach.
Left all open and burying it with her left hand is Taylor Harpenau. She's got six.
And they forgot about her. Everybody's attention was up front, and Harpenau just snuck in behind and was wide open.
Now the dump down. Grand Jeanette.
They're finding ways and they're finding openings in this defense. They're taking away Audie Crooks, but others are stepping up.
Aulish can't get it to fall. Rebound to Crooks.
You know, that was just a textbook rebound, what she did. She went up, she kept it up above her head, pivoted, looked to see who her outlet was going to be, and then handed it off to Joyce. But, you know, that's what you do. You pull that rebound, you keep it up above your head.
Rebound tipped out. It stays with Garrigan. Grand Jeanette has it swatted away. Dreckman with her second block of the night. Royals going to go back to their bench. Maya Holmes with those two fouls will check back into the game. She's in for Lecce.
And let's see if they keep her down low and if she has her attention on Crooks, because she's going to have to play smart with those two fouls.
Dreckman with a rebound will outlet it ahead to Harpenau.
Boy, they had Hillbrands, but they couldn't find her soon enough. She was wide open down in the block, beat everybody else down the floor.
Hillbrands from the baseline. The Royals have gotten some good looks, still down by six.
Well, they're not letting it get too far out of hand. They're staying with Bishop Garrigan.
And Joyce turning on the afterburners to get that bucket.
But you have to be able to control that, and they have up until this point. And Joyce, when she can get a little momentum and a head of steam behind her, she is going to be able to turn the corner and get downhill.
24-16, the three off the mark, and a foul going to be called on Garrigan. This goes against Capacious. That's her first. So an 8-point lead here for Garrigan with 3:54 to play in the first half.
Oh, and you and I had talked before this ball game, said neither team can get in foul trouble, and they really haven't. They've been playing very smart. Not a lot of fouls been called here in this first half.
Here's Dreckman from the baseline, the kick out. Literally.
Yeah.
Dreckman again.
Wow, that is a really good move as far as Dreckman. Just one step around, little floater off the glass, and she's going to go to Kirkwood next year and play a little basketball and then see if she can find a home after that.
24-18. Now they're going to spread the floor here. Are the Golden Bears? My question is, who's left at home in Algona? And also Marcus Merritt and Claghorn Remsen Union. There's a lot of folks here watching Molly Joyce starting to take over this game ever so slightly. She's got six.
25 points in each of the first two games of this tournament for Molly Joyce. She is a volume scorer.
Crooks with another rebound. I mean, what a turnout for the 1A championship.
The full lower bowl is, for the most part, crowded. I mean, there's a few seats, but a lot of people have come out to watch these two talented teams.
Joyce with a dump down to Crooks on the block, the feed to Capacious.
Capacious has been the recipient of the defense's attention to Audie Crooks, and Audie Crooks eyed her immediately as she received that pass, waiting for her to cut down the lane.
Okay, the Royals are in trouble, down by double figures at 10. Dreckman, the step in the lane. Can't get it to fall. Was she in the act of shooting? Yes. She'll go to the line to shoot two.
And that's a really good athletic move. She comes up against Crooks, waits for her to come up to her, and then does that step through move up and under.
A foul called against Tigas. That's her second. Coming back into the game is Montag. Going out, Grand Jeanette for Bishop Garrigan. Royals at 26-1, the only defeat to Unity Christian. And Dreckman can't get that free throw to fall. Still a 10-point game. For the Bears, interesting start to the year. First six games, they were 3-3. But man, did they schedule up. 5A Iowa City West, 3A West Lyon. As there's a steal by Dreckman, and they also played later in the year Dyke New Hartford and Newell Fonda. They beat Dyke New Hartford, lost to Newell Fonda in Newell by four. Dreckman's three, well short. Aulish will call it a pass. Harpenau to work. The big three by Holmes. Can't get it to fall. And the Royals have gone cold from the floor. And a timeout going to be taken here by the Bears. 28-18, 1:20 to play here in the opening half. Let's go to the Royals huddle.
We yelled money, but we didn't communicate, and then we ran away from the ship. Okay? You have to run money, okay? Emily has to be on the side, because she's being guarded. Maybe even put you down low. Keep you up top. All right, we're going to keep you up top. All right, when that ball goes in, you got to go away from that one.
Wait, should I be the one that shoots because I can screen Molly?
Yeah, sure.
What?
Hey.
But then you got to come set a screen on Molly.
Let's go.
Read it.
They're just trying to figure out a way how they can start knocking down some shots. And that, you're right, they've gone cold. They need to figure out a way to get some things going here in the last minute 20. They don't want to let this get too far out of hand. They need to get a stop right here, then get back and try to get a quick bucket on offense.
Jillian Lecce actually started her collegiate basketball career at Iowa State, was a Minnesota Prep. There for a couple of years, went to Concordia, played overseas. Now coaching Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union. The kick out, Joyce for three. Got it!
The great vision of Crooks knew that she was had the double team, then the triple team, stays on the baseline and whips a pass out to Joyce.
This one gonna be deflected out of bounds. It's gonna stay with Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union. Grand Jeanette will come back into the game. She'll check in for Capacious. You almost got the feel. Joyce and Crooks have remained in this game with this lead. It's almost as if they're trying to go for the knockout punch here. The jumper by Aulish is able to go through.
Well, and if you can get that knockout punch right before halftime, it just serves you better in the second half. They're gonna hold here for one. That's a big bucket and kind of a bucket that's a sigh of relief for the Royals because they needed something heading in to halftime. And if they can get the stop here, you gotta feel like they're gonna have a little pep in their step heading back to the locker room.
Montag to Joyce out on the wing for three. Can't get it to fall. The putback by Montag, no good, but she is fouled on the play by Aulish. And Montag to the line to shoot two with 1.1 remaining. Boy, stay tuned, coming up the half, festivities all week long. And they're gonna remember that 1972 Roland Story team that won the state championship. They're gonna honor them here at the halftime. We saw a terrific tribute video that we had last night in the 3A title game on that team. Highlights, more coming up at the half. And able to knock down the shot is Montag. Hits one out of two. And the clock a little slow to start. And that shot a little high and hard. So we have played one half of basketball. The Garrigan Golden Bears of Algona have a 12-point lead. And I tell you what, shots are really falling well for them in the first half, thanks to Audie Crooks
Look
and
at her
company.
Just tiptoe the baseline. And Joyce didn't handle the pass right away, but she was able to get that little dribble, gather the feet, and knock down a big three-pointer. And that is something that has been big in this half for Garrigan. They are knocking down threes. I think they're about 44% from three.
Let's go to Paul Yeager.
All right, thank you very much, BJ and Laura. Appreciate your time there as we continue on with our halftime. As BJ just teased, we have all sorts of things coming. One of them is the coaches' conversation. Brandon Schwab, head coach at Bishop Garrigan. Coach, I wrote down Audie early. She has seven. Balanced scoring, Joyce warming up with nine. Fair assessment of the first half?
Absolutely. You know, we're taking what the defense gives us. Right now they want to put three on Audie early in that game. They want to put three on Audie. They made an adjustment defensively here and switched to 2-3 to end that. But we're going to take what the defense gives us and right now and keep moving the ball.
Speaking of defense, you're holding them to 20 points. Do you consider that a good sign?
Absolutely. If we can hold them to another 20 this half, we're going to be in good shape. So I like where we're at defensively.
Make sure Colin gets a chance to give a speech here at halftime, Coach.
He's got thanks. The halftime. I'm just going to sit back.
All right. Thank you very much, Brandon Schwab.
All right, thanks.
Appreciate the time. And we're going to go back down courtside now. As BJ also mentioned, it is time to celebrate a 50-year team. Let's meet Roland Story. No one.
Girls High School Athletic Union's Golden Plaque of Distinction Award honors the Iowa coach who has demonstrated a successful career while making notable contributions towards school, community, and the coaching profession. Presenting the Golden Plaque of Distinction Award is IGHSAU Executive Director Gene Berger and Basketball Administrator Gary Ross. The 2022 recipient of the Golden Plaque Award is Nicole Goodwin of Kingsley Pearson. Nicole is in her 19th year as the head girls basketball coach at Kingsley Pearson. She has rebuilt the program and won 7 Western Valley Conference titles and the conference tournament 4 times. Her teams have played in 8 1A regional finals and have been state qualifiers 3 times. Nicole has been the IGCA Coach of the Year 6 times and the IBCA Coach of the Year 3 times. She was awarded the NFHS State Coach of the Year and the NFHS Sectional Coach of the Year in 2020 and 2019. She has also served on the IGHSAU Basketball Advisory Committee. Coach Goodwin is in her 20th year teaching K through 8 physical education at Kingsley Pearson. She also serves as the athletic director and school to work coordinator. Nicole and her husband Todd have 4 children, Madison, Mackenzie, Beau, and Blakely. Congratulations to the 2022 recipient of the Golden Plaque of Distinction Award from Kingsley Pearson, Nicole Goodwin. Basketball tournament pauses every year to honor its rich history with the induction of the latest class of basketball Hall of Famers. It is estimated that over 700,000 girls have played basketball in Iowa high schools. Out of this impressive number, 244 girls spanning 102 years have been inducted into the Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union's Basketball Hall of Fame. Today, 3 more legends of the hardwood have been selected as Basketball Hall of Famers. Let's meet this year's class. Presenting Hall of Fame awards is President of the Iowa Farm Bureau, Brent Johnson. Our first inductee is Julie Goodrich from Adel High School. Julie starred at Adel in the early 1970s and contemplated and complimented teammate and fellow Hall of Famer Joyce Elder in the Adel forward court. A 2-year starter, she was part of the 1973 team that reached the state championship game, averaging 30.8 points a game. As a senior, she earned all-state honors, averaging 33 points a game, as Adel placed 2nd in the state tournament for the 2nd straight season. An outstanding multi-sport athlete, she won 100 career games as a standout pitcher and also a state qualifying track athlete. Graduating in 1974, Julie was able to take advantage of the newly passed Title IX legislation and was one of 38 female athletes to receive athletic scholarships at Iowa State, where she became one of the top scorers in the early history of Cyclone women's basketball. Julie now lives and works in Rio Verde, Arizona, with her husband, Mark. Fans, welcome to the Hall of Fame, from Adel High School, Julie Goodrich. Our next honoree starred at Waterloo West High School from 1999 to 2003. Basketball was in her DNA early as she grew up watching older cousins star for Waterloo East and Waterloo West High Schools. She became a starter as a freshman and led Waterloo West to the state tournament her junior and senior seasons. She led the Wahawks to the 2002 state championship game and earned a spot on the all-tournament team. She ended her career scoring 1,433 points and was a 3-time All-State selection. After receiving multiple scholarship offers, she committed to the University of California. She helped the Bears reach 2 NCAA tournaments. Known for her tenacious defense, she broke into the starting lineup her senior year, where she averaged 7 points and 4 rebounds a contest. After living for some time and working in San Francisco, She now resides in Bloomington, Minnesota, where she works as a recruiter and a counselor at Normandale Community College. She has two sons, 9-year-old Keon and 4-year-old Kyrie. She now takes her place with former Waterloo West stars Molly Goodenbauer and Nina Smith as Hall of Famers. Let's welcome her home from Waterloo West, Hall of Famer Kiana Levy.
The tournament queen is crowned, and all 16 squads are on hand to salute her. Governor Robert D. Ray gives the official greetings to the girls. The 1972 queen could not be more qualified. She's Judy Precenter, an all-state forward who came into the tournament as the fourth all-time scorer in her school's rich basketball history. But that's only part of the story.
The queen year was 1972. Pitcher, tragedy marred the 1972 Summer Olympics in Munich. Moviegoers were introduced to the Corleone family in The Godfather. Atari debuted its Pong video game. And Michael Jackson hit the charts with his song Rockin' Robin. Some great music was also being made at Roland Story High School in 1972. Led by legendary coach Bill Hennessy, the Norseman girls basketball team had a penchant for singing off the court while winning basketball games on the court. After falling to Mighty Montezuma in the first round of the 1971 tournament, they spent the rest of the state tournament week watching from the stands and made it their mission to make sure their tournament journey would last longer in 1972. The season had some rocky moments to start with. Beginning the year with a 2-3 record, the Norsemen righted their ship after Christmas break to earn another trip to the state tournament with a modest 19-5 record. Roland Story topped West Branch in the first round game and followed that with a win over Laverne when future Hall of Famer Kathy Kameen poured in 56 points. The Norsemen staged an epic rally to edge West Central 91-90 in a nail-biting semifinal win. Roland Story met up with Guthrie Center in the championship game. The contest was back and forth early on, with the lead changing hands 8 times in the first quarter. However, Kathy Kameen took charge of the game in the second half, scoring 39 points, while Deb Sanson added 17 points and Sharon Nelson scored 12. The guard court of Karen Ritland, Janice Brothen, and Deb Sampson kept West Central's Judy Merritt in check as the Norsemen captured the 1972 state crown with a 68-64 win. Let's welcome them back for the 50th anniversary of their 1972 state basketball title, the Roland Story Norsemen. Janice Brothen Billerbeck, Kim Clark Severson, Janet Greg Hansecker, Kathy Hennessy Jerome, Sue Hennessy Landy, Kathy Kameen Brothen, Jackie Michelson Foley, Jane Michelson Hovick, Sharon Nelson Harstick, Geraldine Peter Rasmussen, assistant coach Judy Reese Tay, Karen Ritland Munson, Deb Sampson Gaunt, Gail Solis DeMoss, Barb Toth Black. Congratulations and welcome back to the Girls State Basketball Tournament.
If you want to see more on this team, go to our website, iowapbs.org, or our YouTube channel. You can see a conversation with those ladies. And I also want to let you know that Iowa PBS is committed to telling stories about young Iowans who are doing exceptional things by celebrating their success and sharing their journey through a digital series that we call In Their Words. Meet Bishop Garrigan's Audie Crooks, who has been shattering records and setting the freshman single-season scoring mark with 626 points.
I'm Audie Crooks, and I play basketball at Bishop Garrigan High School. I think I first really got into basketball probably around the first grade, just through rec league and YMCA league. I tried a lot of different sports as a kid, but I always grew up, you know, hearing about my mom. She was a past state participant here at Bishop Garrigan, and my dad was a good player also on that Fort Dodge team. So it's definitely been, you know, in the back of my mind, and just hearing as a child, you know, you're gonna be a ball player, and I just kind of stuck with the sport. I think as a kid, I was pretty decent, but I don't think anybody would have thought that I would progress to the player that I am today. My mom always made sure that we had a hoop in the driveway, so her and I would just go out and play pig and horse and stuff. And it really started to kind of pick up in junior high and seventh grade when I got on the AAU circuit and learned some things, picked up some skills, kind of got the basics from my mom and just taught myself and took off from there. I am currently 6'3", and as a child, I was always the tallest in my class, so I've been used to being pretty tall. I don't think I really noticed a spurt, but I know in junior high, I was probably about 6'1", so I've always been up here. I broke the state record for points scored as a freshman with 626 points. Right now, I'm averaging right around 23 points per game, 12 rebounds per game. My mother currently owns the best field goal percentage in career, and I have the best field goal percentage in a season. So I have to wait till I'm a senior to see if I'm gonna pass her up. And that's definitely, you know, definitely some trash talking at home about that and seeing if I'm gonna pass her up and knock her off the board.
I think Michelle's enjoying the last couple year and a half of having her picture
on the thing. Yes, definitely pointing it out.
State at the end of the year is just where every team wants to be, and I think it's a blessing to have been able to been there both my freshman and my sophomore year, and we're having a pretty good campaign this year. State is just a really fun, really cool experience, just playing in that big arena and knowing that, you know, what you've been working for towards the season has paid off. My freshman and sophomore year both ended up with state runner-up trophies, which isn't a ship, but it's still a blessing, and I think we performed really well down there in Des Moines. So I've been recruited by all of the D1 in-state schools, by some schools on the East Coast, West Coast, down south, up north. The next level is tough, and so as a player, you have to evolve and change your game and step it up, whether that be developing more range or being more comfortable, solidifying post moves, expanding your basketball IQ. All of that's gonna be necessary to be successful at the college level. One thing that's always been really important to me is relationships. So building a bond and finding, you know, a school with that family atmosphere, that feeling of, you know, people have your back. Because I'm definitely a people person. I'm a talker. Coach will testify to that during practice sometimes. I also play volleyball, and I'm in track, and I am in choir, band, and speech. I really like just being involved because it gives you an opportunity to learn about yourself and learn about new people and just meet friends and branch out outside of just, you know, the basketball team. Basketball has given me a lot in terms of relationships, and it's taught me how to handle a lot of life's lessons, such as adversity and learning to overcome obstacles and to face challenges and just to persist.
Number 55, Audie Crooks.
My goal for this year is to get back to Wells Fargo and to win a state championship. Whenever I'm in school and I see some young girls in the hallway, they'll always come up to me and ask me for high fives or ask me, you know, about the game tonight. And it just means a lot to me that I can contribute and bring attention to Bishop Garrigan basketball, not only that, but also to Iowa girls basketball and, you know, the kind of movement that's going on with females in sports.
Funding for In Their Words is provided by Musco Lighting, and the Pella Roll Screen Foundation.
We roll on here at halftime, and joining us now is MMCRU coach Jillian Lecce. And coach, Emily Dreckman was doing her best to keep your team. How do you get others to be like Emily?
To be honest, they're all their own breed. Each one has a special quality that brings to this team. I'd like 17 of Emily's, but I would also like 17 of Ellie and Taylor and Cora. I mean, they're all great players in their own way, and they all show it.
What else did you talk about at halftime?
At halftime, we had to change it up a little bit. You know, our defense wasn't working, so we had to revamp it. We had a few options to work on, and we just got to go back to what we do best.
All right. Appreciate your time, Coach. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, we will continue here. We're going to have another In Their Words story. This time we're going to introduce you to Katie Lindsay, who's breaking records as a female kicker for the Van Meter Bulldogs football team.
I'm Katie Lindsay, and I'm the kicker for the state champion Van Meter Bulldogs. Started in third grade when I started soccer. I always had a big brother, and he played football, and my sister also played soccer. And so they kind of brought me up, you know, using my leg, and it just kind of went from there. Summer after freshman year, I realized that I could help the Van Meter football team by kicking. The Van Meter football program has been amazing, but there was not a girl on the team. I started off by going to a meeting with the whole team and a few coaches. You know, nobody really said anything, but after that, I worked with my brother and he helped me kick a little bit, and I went to a couple camps. They really helped me. I don't think I'd be where I am without them. The first week of team camp, I wouldn't say lonely, but I was not as interactive. I think people didn't take me seriously at first. And then, you know, I got the position as first team PAT kicker. First game, I went 6-for-6. I walked out to see my family. And, you know, there was a big group of girls there, and they were like, "Oh my gosh, Katie Lindsay, you're so cool." And then, you know, some guys passed, and they were like, "Hey, good game, Katie." So I'm kind of one of them. At first in the summer, during some camps, I worked with a long snapper and holder, and I had a pretty slow time. And then I worked with Jack and Ike during the actual season, and some coaches, they told me to go a little faster, and I started trusting them more. There was one where we had 10 PATs, and then either the week after or 2 weeks after, I had 11, and I broke my own record. I had 2 field goals. You know, they weren't as common because we scored so many touchdowns. Having 71 PATs in just the regular season, I was second in state. You know, without my team and everyone scoring touchdowns and, you know, everyone blocking for me on my PATs, I wouldn't be anywhere near where I am. In the beginning of the season, it was definitely just a lot of fun, you know, being able to kick PATs and helping the team, not tremendously, but it was definitely there. And then in the championship game, you know, at the end, it came down to that one field goal.
Pettit to pass again. This one to the corner of the end zone, has a man open, touchdown!
The state championship game was our closest game of the season.
And it is right through the middle.
It was 7-0, then 7-7. And then we got another touchdown. It was 14-7.
Fourth down and decision time now for Van Meter.
So they sent me out for a field goal.
Well, it looks like they're going field goal. It'll be about a 29-yarder.
There was a guy, and I'm pretty sure the ball went through his arms.
Good snap.
And, you know, it hit the upright, and it felt like it dangled in the air for 10 seconds at least.
The kick is up, and it hits the upright, and it comes through. It's good.
And then it went in. It was a great moment.
So from 27 yards out.
I was believed to be the first girl to score playing football in the Unidome ever. And I was like, wow, that's kind of crazy to think about. Walking through school, some girls would come up to me and say, "Oh my gosh, are you the girl who plays football?" You know, and they're like kind of amazed, and then they go talk to their friends. I think girls being in football should be normalized, whether they're kicking or, you know, they're the linebacker. I am very excited for next season. I think it's gonna be fantastic. I wouldn't say joining football was easy. You know, I definitely had to earn my spot, and same with everyone else. I saw football as something I could do, something that I didn't know I would succeed at so much. You know, I didn't plan on falling in love with it, but I definitely did. If you want to do something that's against the norm, definitely go for it. Nobody cares, and if they do, they probably won't say anything, and if they do, you know, keep doing it.
Funding for In Their Words is provided by Musco Lighting and the Pella Roll Screen Foundation.
All right, it is time for the second half with Laura Leonard. I'm BJ Shaven. Right now, Garrigan with a 12-point lead. Laura, what really sticks out at you with the first half statistics?
You know, really the biggest thing is the fact that MMCRU is 1 of 9 from the three-point range, and if they could knock down a couple more of those, that would help them climb back into this game. And otherwise, they haven't turned the ball over a whole lot. They haven't, they've played a pretty clean game. Bishop Garrigan has hit on all cylinders. They're winning the rebounding battle, and you pointed this out. Audie Crooks, 8 points, or excuse me, 7 points, 8 rebounds, and 3 assists. Potential triple-double.
See what happens here. There she goes for it with the assist, but a travel's going to be called. Crooks now with 9 rebounds, but a 12-point lead. Just what the Royals could use is stops.
Need to string a couple of stops together, and you heard Coach Lecce say that they were going to revamp their defense and do a few things differently. We'll see how that pans out for them here to start this third quarter.
Here's Dreckman. Back outside, Holmes. Going to stay with Marcus Merritt and Claghorn Remsen Union. Halftime festivities, Hall of Fame class, the 1972 Roland Story team. Man, the tradition just continues to grow here with the Girls State Basketball Tournament. Dreckman will get it in from the baseline. She'll work baseline. And the Royals, boy, Allish wanted nothing of that. Now to the corner, there's Harpenau. Can't get it to fall. Hillebrand's shot blocked, but a foul gonna be called. And I believe this is against Crooks, which will be her second, yes.
Hillebrand's only got 4 shots in the first half, and she is a player that they need to get involved a little bit more. Get her in the scheme of things, get her in the rotation. She's able to get to the glass and pull a rebound and go back up, step to the free throw line. But she's somebody that they need when you have somebody that can score like she does in a variety of ways. You need to have her get some touches.
Hillebrand's now with 5. Here's Crooks on the block. He draws contact on Hillebrand's. That'll be her first.
So in the first half, they had Maya Holmes down behind. They were sandwiching Audie Crooks. Looks like they're switching things up. They've got Hillebrand's playing behind Crooks. And we'll see how that matchup prevails over here the next two quarters.
Audie Crooks trying to add to the lead, and she does. Came into the game averaging 24 per contest. Now getting closer to double figures. Dreckman to Hillebrand's. Boy, swam right into that double team, and Crooks just stole it away.
She just is kind of that player down low, just hangs around in the middle, comes over, steps over to help on the double team, got the steal.
Joyce to Crooks. And a charge going to be called on Crooks. That's going to be her third. Now for Brandon Schwab, decision time.
They got the defensive rotation. Holmes comes over as Crooks makes her power move to the glass. And there you can see the call by the official.
Schwab surveying his team. He's a farmer by trait. You apply the fungicide, don't you? They're going to apply it as they keep Crooks in, and then the big three by Holmes.
How about Holmes getting the help and the defensive stop, and then steps up and knocks down a big three-pointer.
Here's the dump down to Crooks. Back outside. Grand Jeanette, the answer.
I love that underhand pitch. That's exactly what it was to the outside. She knew the double team was coming and just scoops it outside.
Holmes for three. Got it!
You can tell with Holmes when she starts feeling it. She has developed over the last year. First year, she'd go 100 miles an hour. Now she has really slowed things down. The game has slowed down, and she is becoming an important player here in this ball game.
Joyce spots up. And the rebound to Holmes.
We haven't said Molly Joyce's name a whole lot here to start the third quarter, so the defensive change and what they've decided to do in the locker room at halftime right now is paying dividends.
Hillbrands fights for the rebound. Now the kick out. They're going to reset. Harpenau. Hillbrands thought about it. Crooks right there. This pass going to be deflected out. It's going to stay with Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn. Remsen Union wearing the dark uniforms. And a timeout going to be taken here by Bishop Garrigan. Boy, the threes are starting to fall.
Look at that. Right away, she recognizes. She didn't even look at the basket. She just flips it outside to the wing for the three-pointer. And how about Maya Holmes knocking down another three-pointer? She's feeling pretty good about her third quarter.
Schwab talking things over with Audie Crooks. Over on this side, the Royals getting so a little bit closer with an eight, had a 12-point deficit there.
And you have to assume that MMCRU is talking about when they're on offense, trying to take it into the middle, trying to challenge Audie Crooks, see if they can pick up one more foul on her.
So the Royals have the basketball. Trying to claw their way back into this one. And here's Emily Dreckman to put it in play. Aulish. Holmes quickly covered up now. Harpenau from 15. And a foul going to be called here on Aulish.
Trying to work a little motion, a little dribble drive to see if they could find something to open up.
A little pressure here now by the Royals.
Like a little 1-2-1-1. And this is not a token full court pressure. They're going to go after it.
Joyce to Crooks. Isolation, had it off her foot. Joyce will pick it up. Left open. Can't get the shot. And it's going to go to the Royals.
So they're throwing a lot of different things. Usually it's Bishop Garrigan that will throw a lot of different looks at you. Hybrid full court, they'll go man, they'll go 2-3, they'll go 1-3-1. They're just, Coach Schwab is very comfortable using all kinds of defenses, but right now his offense is looking at changing defenses and they have to try to navigate through that.
Royals will move it around. Aulish will launch. Can't get the roll. Crooks with the rebound.
It's her 10th rebound.
So Audie Crooks already into double digits with rebounds. Points getting closer. Now to the outside. Tigges. And the rebound to Dreckman. She'll run it ahead. Aulish. Contact and will go to the line to shoot two. Good vision by Dreckman to find her teammate.
As soon as she got that ball in her hands, it was a track meet. And she got it to the half court line and dishes off to Aulish, who was able to go hard to the rim and get to the line.
Now for the Royals, they need to hit free throws here. 5 of 8 for the night. And coming into the game for the first time late half, Zoe Montag, the freshman. She'll come in for Grand Jeanette. So Audie Crooks playing with three fouls, 3:01 to play here in the third. 6-point game. Surprised by the pressure here, or not?
A little bit. I think you got to change it up and put a little bit of pressure on him to see if you can change things up. But when you have point guard like Molly Joy, she just was able to dribble her way through it.
The speed, and now the kick out and a turnover. 8-point game, and Garrigan gets the ball back.
Look at Molly Joyce just surveying the floor, takes her time, gets a little screen up top, and that sets her free, able to step by everybody else that was coming to try to guard her.
Last championship here of the 2022 Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union State Championships, and Molly Joyce with another bucket.
What about a pinball? That's exactly what she was. Makes the drive again, gets bounced around on her way, lets it fly, got some friendly roll.
Lead back to 10. Joyce with 13 in the game, and a travel going to be called. And another turnover for Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union.
It's starting to play to their tempo now. It's starting to heat up. It's starting to speed up. And the Royals kind of slowed it down for a little bit to start this third quarter. And now the pace is picking up, and Garrigan is winning that battle.
First and Lecce into the game. She replaces Holmes. Joyce with that left-hand quick step. Can't get the layup here. And the rebound to Aulish. That's her power of hand, and the Royals are giving it to her.
And you can see that's exactly what they have seen in this defense, and they're trying to exploit that. They're going to go man. If they're going to pick up full court, they're going to put it in the hands of Molly Joyce.
Dreckman able to get the tough bucket.
That's a good power move, and she was able to get the defense off to the side on her backside, get a good lead pass that led her right into the rim.
I'm sure her dad, Bruce, enjoying that. Here's Crooks to work, gets the bucket there. And now each team trading baskets. 10-point game again. First you see Dreckman with the ball right now, can't get that bucket to fall. Her dad, I think we'd all like to see him working right now. He's a Major League Baseball umpire. But because of the strike, he's actually here in attendance and able to watch his daughter play here at the state tournament.
Yeah, he said the good and the bad of it is, well, we're not working right now, but the good is that we can come and watch the tournament and watch my daughter play. They would like to get to work and play a little baseball, but right now he's getting to enjoy his daughter.
Hillbrands will pick up the foul. That's her second. You see why Crooks is so powerful on the block. Crooks now with 11. Capacious will get a rest. Ashley Hovey is into the game. And it looks like Grand Jeanette will come back in. She's going to check in for Audie Crooks here with 34 seconds to play in the quarter and a 12-point lead for Garrigan. This is right where it was at the break. Royals going to look at the 2-3 zone here.
You know, we talked about them switching up defenses, and they're comfortable playing anything defensively.
The putback, not there, and the rebound to Joyce. She's got time. Out ahead. Here's Montag, and she's going to be called for a walk.
Just couldn't handle the pass. Just couldn't get the footwork right. Otherwise, it was an easy layup. They're going to put a little pressure in the backcourt with only 6.5 seconds left here.
Dreckman outside the deep three. And it rolls off for Aulish. It's a 12-point lead for Garrigan. 8 minutes to play here in the Class 1A state championship. So how far did each team have to go to get here to Des Moines? Well, it's about a half a tank or more for Marcus Barrett and Claiborne Remsen Union. 198 miles, and Bishop Garrigan, 138 miles. So they've come from the northern part of the state. Boy, they are being treated here tonight, here in the 1A championship game. With Lauren Leonard, I'm B.J. Shaven, and Laura, a 12-point lead for Garrigan, trying to get their school's first ever state championship. They're in great position right now.
Yeah, they really are, and they had survived a little bit of a run that the Royals threw at them to start the third quarter. You have to figure they have a few more things up their sleeve, but I think Garrigan is going to be ready for that. They've been denied the championship two different times. They are ready to take one home tonight.
Okay, how do the Royals get back into this game?
Well, I think you're going to see a little bit more pressure, and they also need to get some three-point shots up as well. They got hot there early in the third quarter. Need to start that rotation offensively to try to look to set up those three-point shots.
Well, it's a 12-point lead for Garrigan. 8 minutes to play for the 1A title, and what a week it's been here in Des Moines.
It really has been. It always is, and you get up and you know on that Monday morning of the state tournament, 10 o'clock, games are going to start. We're going to have games morning to nighttime, fans coming in and out, and we had some quality games here this week, and I'll tell you, the crowds have been great, and it's just nice to be able to have fans back in the stands being loud and raucous and cheering for their teams.
So here we go, 8 minutes to play, and on the floor for Bishop Garrigan, it'll be Capacious, Joyce, Crooks back out on the floor along with Grand Jeanette, and also Tigges. Now for the Royals, Harpenau, Dreckman, Aulish, Holmes, and Hillbrands. Joyce, again, given her left hand, will attack, and she'll go to the line to shoot two.
They're setting that screen up. She's taking it to the right side of the floor, and they're setting that screen to set her up to go left. And you're right, that is her dominant hand. She likes to go that way. But they're attacking this defense in the correct way of getting that high screen to let her navigate.
Molly Joyce, player of the year in the top of Iowa Conference. And the rebound comes down to Holmes. Lead now the largest it's been at 13. Some monster possessions here for Marcus Baird and Claghorn Remsen Union.
They were able to, early in the third quarter, go in and draw a couple of quick fouls on Audie Crooks, and they're going to need to do that and try to attack her as well. See if they can get her out of the game for just a few minutes and see if they can cut into the lead.
Who's going to provide the spark? Maybe it's Maya Holmes. She's got 8.
Maya Holmes has knocked down a couple of big buckets here, and gets inside and kisses one off the glass.
Now it's about getting stops. And there's one.
Holmes with the dribble drive just gets into the gap, just the separation. Crooks didn't adjust and get over quick enough, and Holmes able to knock it in. She's calling for the basketball right now. She's feeling pretty good about her game.
Arpinau over to Dreckman. Joyce going to be locked in on Dreckman. Here's the three. This is going to be left short. And the rebound to Grant Jeanette.
The other player that needs to get involved is Hillbrands. She needs to be involved, and she's being a screener right now. She's trying to set up her teammates. She scored over 1,000 points in her career, and she needs to have the ball in her hands here in the fourth quarter.
Dreckman just picked up her first foul, the 15th foul called on the Royals here in the late half, and now a timeout from their bench. So Bishop Garrigan
prepared for that because it is
has
going
been
to
a
be
runner-up
that
the last couple of years. Myers. Newell Fonda has been the nemesis that's kept them away from a state title. Last year they were the top overall seed, had things going their way before Newell Fonda made them a runner-up 2 years in a row. And now this year, Newell Fonda knocked off in the semifinals by this team right here on your screen, Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union. Let's take a listen inside of that huddle with head coach Jillian Lecce.
Wait for this to happen.
Yes, and look for backside. And then Tay, if Tay's over here, Cora, if that's not open and we get this here, boom, look for there. Let's go. Defensively, you're on 11. Let's go.
Royals on three. One, two, three. Royals.
And where do you mark me out if she's just going to dive there?
If she's gonna dive here,
she's gonna dive here.
You have to be there. You have to be there.
Okay, so starting five for each team out on the floor. Garrigan will put it in play with Capacious. Out of Joyce, who will be locked in on by Aulish.
And you heard right out of the huddle. She looked at Aulish and said, you're on 11. Stick with her.
Garrigan gonna be careful. The shot by Grand Jeanette off the mark. Dreckman up with it. Out ahead, Arpinau goes to the hoop. I think she saw out of the corner of her eye Audie Crooks coming.
And it was a really nice lead pass by Dreckman as well. I wasn't sure how she was gonna get it through all the outstretched arms, and you're right, she felt the presence of Crooks on her backside when Arpinau went up with that shot.
Now a foul called here on the Royals. One more, Garrigan in the bonus the rest of the way. That's the second on Dreckman.
And you can't afford right now to try to foul and prolong this game. You don't have the depth to start doing that. You got to wait a few more minutes before you go to that strategy.
Arpinau with the rebound. Out ahead, Crooks deflected it and comes up with a steal. And then ran into Arpinau, who will pick up the foul, and Crooks will come down to the other end to shoot free throws.
Little collision in the middle, but just getting back defensively. Crooks gets a hand in the passing lane, and Arpinau and Crooks collide, and they got a little knock near the eye. She was rubbing her eye, but pops right back up.
Audie able to knock down the first one. What a year for Audie Crooks, both on and off the court. Of course, her father passed away throughout the year. And in memory of him, she has a tattoo on her right inside of her forearm. Her pops has a Bible verse, Proverbs 3:9. And also has special shoes that are custom made that has pops on them. So as we take a look at those shoes, yep, that's for Dad.
It's a nice way to always have him with you and have that memory of him with you. And I know she feels that presence with her, and that's why she does those things. It's a nice tribute.
12-point Garrigan lead, and they've got the ball. Joyce gonna run some clock here. They want the title.
Gonna run the weave up top and see what they can do, turn it over. But you know, you play all game at a certain pace and then you slow it down with about 5 minutes to go. Sometimes you turn the ball over a few times and you allow a team to get back into it.
Harpenow. Hollis with the rebound, put back is there.
So they got the stop down on the one end, were able to get the 2 points on their end. Now they're gonna come with the pressure.
And a travel gonna be called here on Tigas.
Crooks was down saying, come on, I'm gonna seal off the defender. You have a free lane to get to the rim. And there was just a little bit of indecision with Tigas, and she shuffled her feet.
Here's Dreckman working the baseline. Aulis with the tough spin. Can't get it to fall. Hillbrand's the kick out. The three. Good by Maya Holmes.
That's just hard work down low. Hillbrand's just battling for that rebound, desperately looking for somebody to kick it out to, and Holmes with another big bucket.
Each team with three timeouts remaining. It's a 7-point game. The Golden Bears have been in stall mode, and this one's tied up. Turnover.
You get the hustle on the boards, and Holmes knocks one down. Hillbrand's a great job of keeping that ball on her fingertips and pulling it in, hitting the outside, an open player.
Hillbrand's been quiet tonight. Now to the corner, Harpenow. Whoa! We've got ourselves a 4-point game with 3 minutes to play and a foul in backcourt here on Aulis.
That is a definition of a rainbow jumper. That ball went high in the air and it goes out of the picture and finally comes down through the net. Big bucket for the Royals.
And Joyce out of the one-on-one misses it. Aulis up with a rebound out ahead.
Smart, they didn't have the numbers, have the chance to set up.
Harpenow pulls up, and it's a 2-point game just like that. What a run! And now a foul on the inbounds pass can be called on Aulis, and that's gonna be her fourth.
Skip the pass. Harpenow just instead of setting up for the three, puts ball on the floor, pulls up for that short jumper.
2-point game and a timeout taken here by Garrigan. Let's hear what head coach Brandon Schwab has to say.
Listen, hey, you guys, come to the basketball, be strong. Meredith, check in. Meredith, check in, hurry up. Ashlyn, you're out. Listen, run our offense. We need to get Audie a touch here in the half court, okay? We need to get Audie a touch in the half court. You can beat her off of the dribble there. Just keep getting open, okay? Keep getting open. Defensively, we're in man-to-man. Defensively, match up in man. You're on Dreckman, or I'm sorry, you're on Hildebrandt. You're on 35, okay? Keep them in man, keep them in man, okay? Now, let's go purple. Go purple. I like where we're at in purple. Talk through that, okay? Get 2 free throws here, okay? Let's go.
You guys got a block out here. We got
it. We are.
definitely have to give Crooks a touch when they get to the offensive end. You got to run that offense through her, and you heard that they started out that they were going to go man, but they're going to change it up. I think they're probably going to go a little bit of zone, but you heard the thing that he said, first and foremost, be strong with the basketball when you get it into the front court.
Joyce out of the 1-1, misses it. Hillbrands with a rebound and an opportunity to take or get a tie or take the lead here. Harpin out down to the baseline. Allish, we're tied at 46.
They just ran the baseline, calmly got it down the right side of the floor, and Allish cuts the baseline, finds that short corner area, and was able to knock it home.
12-0 run, Crooks in the paint, left it short. Rebound put back by Capacious, not there. Now it's going to be controlled by Holmes, but they're going to say it's tied up. It stays with Garrigan.
Dreckman up the floor. Harpinow finds Allish just kind of tiptoeing along the baseline side. Nobody saw her, nobody heard her, and she was wide open.
Allish with four fouls has to be careful. She's been a huge part of this comeback by the Royals. And she's guarding Joyce. What an assignment. Now Harpinow will switch off on her. They get it out to Grand Jeanette, who will hand it off to Joyce.
And I think that's definitely a smart move. You got Taylor Harpinow out on Joyce and not putting your point guard in danger with the four fouls.
And there's Crooks with the big left hand.
Maya Holmes just didn't get over there quick enough. Great spin move by Audie Crooks.
And a foul going to be called here on Capacious, her second. That is just going to be the fourth team foul called on Garrigan.
High-low entry. And Holmes coming over to try to double team. But the good footwork gets Crooks a bucket. And then the bump by Capacious.
Here's Holmes, who's led the comeback. Maya's going to hand it off to Allish. They'll reset.
With those skip passes, those high passes, it allows the defense to get reset.
This is going to be deflected out. Last touch by Garrigan. Royals have it. 1:27 to play. Two-point game. Can they complete the comeback? Here's Dreckman for three. Can't get it. And a rebound to Holmes, and she's fouled.
Over on that weak side, Holmes was in the right spot. And I believe Tigas is going to pick up that foul and puts them closer to the bonus. That's foul number two on Tigas.
1:15 to play. Allish on the drive, in the paint. Wild shot, can't get it to go down. Crooks with a rebound.
See if you can get a steal initially, and if not, then you're going to have to try to stop the clock with a foul.
And a timeout going to be taken here by Garrigan. They'll have one timeout remaining. The Royals with three timeouts remaining. Still a two-point game in favor of Garrigan. Let's see what the Royals have to say.
If Ellie posts up, though, she keeps her at bay, and we can make a little jumper right over top of her.
I know, but what we saw just right there was if we can get attack here and she steps over, one of these girls is going to be open. You know what I'm saying? Okay?
All right. Okay. Audie's in this middle guy, right? We have to attack this way because then we're going to have two girls right here for the layup. All right? We have to get up on D. We have to deny everything.
Like man or?
Yeah, deny everything. They're at that side right now. They're half court. They're half court. Get up on everything. Okay? All right? If it gets down to it, do we foul? Who else doesn't have any right fouls?
I have to.
They drive hard.
But who do we foul? Who do we foul?
Audie. Audie. She's got the worst free throw shooting percentage.
She's making them today.
Well, she's making one of two.
Otherwise, okay. 32 or 22 if they're
last
in.
Time she made one of two.
Okay?
Hey, let's go.
We got this. Attack the heart. No, find a way. Hammer gets you, and then we got a dish right there. Let's go.
Five, two, three, four, five,
talking about who they want to foul, who is on the floor, who they need to foul. They have a couple to give here before they put them in. I take that back, I'm sorry.
Yep.
They will be able to put them in on the line, but it would be for two shots.
Tigges will put it in play, gets it to Joyce, guarded by Harpenau. Well, they've got Crooks going ISO against Hillbrands. Can they find her? Joyce on the dribble. To Grand Jeanette, back to Joyce. Clock continues to tick down. It's a two-point game. Dreckman tried to foul and was unsuccessful. And now we'll get it with the bump. And going to the line is going to be Molly Joyce. Garrigan has missed their last three free throws that they've shot. And for Dreckman, that'll be her third. Joyce at the line. Normally a solid free throw shooter. Set her feet and got that one to go down. It's a three-point game.
They already had set up the offensive play in the huddle for MMCRU. So if this goes through, they know exactly what they need to run. And if you're Bishop Garrigan, you don't want to foul. But here, they're the ones that have the fouls to give. So they can afford to maybe be a little bit more aggressive.
Let's hear what Brandon Schwamm has to say.
You can keep the ball if we get the ball back. There's only going to be about 20 seconds, okay? We've got another timeout if we need it. You need one stop and a rebound right now and to hit a few free throws. We don't need to force anything. No threes, okay?
Hey, we got a foul to give. We
so if something, hey, if they come in something easy, you can make sure they don't get an and one. No and one, no threes.
Match up.
Match up. Let's go. We are, hey, one stop. Two free throws for a title here. One stop.
Hey, clean up the club.
One stop and two free throws to a title. And that's exactly the story. That's what they need to do. They need to get the stop. And you heard they do have some fouls to give. Don't give them the and one to get them any closer.
So they've come back from 12 down to tie it up. Can they come down from four down? Here's Dreckman. In the paint, almost lost it. Hillbrands for three. Got it!
They got the timeout.
17.7 to play. It's a one-point game.
Hillbrands has been quiet most of the ball game. She has not gotten a lot of shots off. They dribble in, get the kick out, and Hillbrands responds with a big three.
Let's go to the Royals huddle.
11's going to try and get that ball. Anybody but 11 get that ball. Hey, okay? You know what? We don't want to foul her. But at the end of the day, if she gets the ball, we got to foul her. We don't have a lot of time to play with here. The only thing we can do is you want to go to our trap. We haven't thrown that at them yet, our full court press.
12?
So we can get it to 11 and just, yeah, boom, boom.
We'll try it.
Another taking ball out, double 11.
Yeah.
To
get the ball inbound.
Yeah.
And you
got to
dig on me.
Yes. Yes.
12. 12.
See, if we haven't thrown it at them yet, let's try it.
Okay, let's try it.
If they get it in and they start going up court, we got chasing down, just touch them in the back or something, it'll be a foul.
Hey, you got four.
Just using you as an example.
Well done, three.
1, 2, 3, 4.
They're going to try to keep the ball out of Molly Joyce's hands. They don't want her going back to the free throw line. So they're going to try to trap. Right away, they're going to deny Joyce the basketball if they can. They're going to do their best to do that. And then whoever gets the ball inbounds, they're going to try to trap right away.
Overall, Marcus Baird and Claycorn Remsen Union came from 13 down to tie it up. Now it's a one-point game. They do get the ball back in to Joyce in backcourt, and she's quickly fouled. 16 seconds even to play. And Molly Joyce to the line, who's regained her stroke.
She stepped up to the line last time, calmly knocked them down. Still a lot of pressure with these free throws. One timeout left for both sides. this one goes, you've got to definitely look for a three-pointer.
Joyce with 17 points. Make it 18, and it's back to a three-point game. They'll get it ahead. Here's Aulish. Now I'll hand it off to Dreckman, and a timeout going to be taken here by Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union. 11.4 seconds to play. Three-point deficit for the Royals. And Garrigan, defensively, what will they draw up here? Well, they've got a foul to give. Let's hear what Brandon Schwab has to say.
Hey, stand up. It's 30. Listen, they have no timeouts left. If they score, you keep it out of bounds. Listen, if they score, you keep it out of bounds. I've got your timeout if we need it.
Can we just all stand on the three-point line and make sure they don't make a three?
Everybody is in a face guard, switch everything. Get up on her. No threes, no threes. Everybody get up on your girls, switch everything. No threes. We do not need to inbound the ball. We are?
Garrigan!
No fouling!
They're gonna try to stop the three, Laura.
Well, they have to stop the three, but, you know, they're going to be guarding on the three-point line. You don't want to foul somebody shooting a three either.
Who gets the shot here for the Royals?
Boy, they're all good three-point shooters. They're all threats from the perimeter. I might go Holmes or Hillbrands.
Aulish will put it in play. They get it into Dreckman. 10 seconds to go. They're going to hand it off to Aulish. Back outside, Harpin out to the corner. Here's a three. It's off the mark on the court. Going to be tied up. Possession arrow. Still keeps it with the Royals. So Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union. No timeouts left. 2.3 seconds to play. Down by three. And now a timeout by Garrigan.
That's going to help MMCRU set things up a little bit.
How are they going to set it up? It's a full timeout here.
They're face guarding. We need a three.
Trump?
We can look for it, but if it's not there, then 2 seconds on the clock. We got to get a three.
Hey,
that was a good shot.
Let's go here, Ellie. Boom, here, you gotta shoot it as soon as you get it.
Who's on your screening?
As soon as you lob it up to her, go.
Who's shooting?
Catch, boom, pass.
Yes.
Okay, here, hold on, start here, stack it. Two girls together, okay? All right, okay? Taylor, start inside, we're lobbing it to Ellie. Taylor, you cut off of this, when she goes up, you get it, boom, shoot it, put it in.
Let's go.
Trying to force overtime here. They have the play drawn up. And you can just cut the tension here in this 1A title game. Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn Remsen Union down by three. Garrigan trying to, they're both trying to win their first ever state championship. The Royals win overtime. Garrigan wants to end it in regulation. Dreckman will inbound it baseline underneath the hoop. Here we go. The lob out top to Hillbrands, back to Harpinow. It's partially blocked, and that's it. Garrigan is your Class 1A state champ.
We knew that it was going to be a very close game. Garrigan got out to that lead, but you got to credit MMCRU. They fought back, and they got it to within an opportunity for them to tie it a couple of different times. Got a couple of good looks, but defense in the very end with a block shot helps Garrigan get their first title.
Great job. Great comeback.
A lot of seniors on this team for the Royals. We've all played together for a long time, came up through the ranks together.
It's time now for the all-tournament team to be announced.
All-tournament team. Presenting the awards is Brent Johnson, president of the Iowa Farm Bureau. Joining him are members of the IGHSAU Board of Directors, Shan Sievert, Travis Fleschner, Russ Adams, Jennifer Donalds, Ron Fadnitz, and Jim Beamer. Here is your Class 1A All-Tournament Team. From MMCRU, Emily Dreckman. From Bishop Garrigan, Audie Crooks. From Newell Fonda, Macy Sievers. From North Lynn, Cameron Kurt. From MMCRU, Taylor Harpinoff. And your Class 1A All-Tournament Team Captain, from Bishop Garrigan, Molly Joyce.
What a tournament for Molly Joyce. And for all these girls on the all-tournament team, Joyce, the captain.
Two 25-point games, a 17-point game tonight. Kind of took over in the fourth quarter for her team. They set her up perfectly, got her going with some drives to the left side. She knocked down free throws late when they really needed them. She had a really nice tournament here this year.
Marcus Merritt and Cleghorn, Remsen Union, all heart in that effort into trying to come back into this game.
They fought and they clawed and they changed things up and they threw a lot of things at Bishop Garrigan, and they were able to fight their way back into the ball game, had a chance to tie it up late.
Now fans, please help us recognize your 2022 Class 1A runner-up, the MMCRU Royals and head coach Jillian Lecce. And fans, let's hear it for your 2022 Class 1A state champion, the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears and head coach Brandon Schwab.
What a way to cap off a week of absolutely fantastic basketball.
It really has been a great week, and this has been a great game. We knew it was going to be a good matchup coming in, and we weren't disappointed. It was close to the finish, and third time's a charm for Bishop Garrigan. They were able to take home the state title, and congratulations to the Golden Bears.
So Bishop Garrigan, a winner. And that's going to wrap it up. But for us here on the floor, let's go to Paul Yeager, who's sitting by in our studio. Paul?
Thank you, BJ Shaven. Thank you, Laura Leonard. Great job, as always, from bringing you the tournament. Got to finish this off. Bishop Garrigan, game number 35. We're done for the 2022 season. Johnston runs the table, goes undefeated. Xavier, the title. Estherville, Lincoln Central, Dyke, New Hartford, and now Bishop Garrigan. It takes an entire crew to make this tournament happen and this broadcast. Thank you to all the men and women who make this happen, and thank you for watching another season of Iowa PBS Sports. It's been a great girls basketball tournament, and we're so honored to be part of the coverage here at Iowa PBS. And the entire state, well, we're going to keep showing you all sorts of great things in the coming months with state championships in soccer, softball, and volleyball right here on Iowa PBS Sports. We are your home for the Iowa Girls High School Athletic Union State Championships. As tradition, we'll leave you with the sights and sounds of another classic tournament alongside a classic tune showcased for decades right here in downtown Des Moines. Good night from Wells Fargo Arena. Funding provided by
you work hard to feed them well. That's why at Fairway, we're committed to our foundation of personalized service while treating our customers like family and valuing our employees. Fairway Meat and Grocery, that's what we're all about.
By Musco Lighting, the sports lighting specialists, providing lighting systems for you, your project, and your community.
Small businesses are the backbone of Iowa's communities, and they are backed by Iowa banks. With advice, loans, and financial services, banks across Iowa are committed to showing small businesses the way to a stronger tomorrow. Learn more at iowabankers.com.